Let's talk about the very early days.
All right.
Shall we, Raj? So what did you do? Put your kit on your back and come up to London?
Well, no, not really, actually. I sort of, I came up and did dentistry in London, and I thought, I didn't know what would happen. I had a kit down in Truro, down in Cornwall. And I suddenly realised that I couldn't stand not being in a group.
We've got Brian May on guitar.
I was studying physics as an undergraduate here, but astronomy was always my thing. And so I did the astronomy postgraduate for a PhD. When we were at school, me and my mates had a group called 1984.
And when I left for university, the singer that we had, Tim Staple, and myself decided to put a new group together called Smile.
We've got Roger Meadows-Taylor on percussion.
There was a notice board somewhere here where you would pin items that were of interest to musicians. So this is where I put my notice saying drummer wanted.
We need Ginger Baker, Mitch Mitchell type drummer. And Brian Mott wrote me this long involved letter, and he sounded quite intelligent, you know, because he liked Jeff Beck and Jimi Hendrix. So I met him and we got on very well. And that was the sort of beginning.
I booked this little jazz club room here and Roger brought his kit in. I brought a guitar and that was the first time we played together. Something happened. I have to say, we thought, there is some kind of special sound to this.
Goodbye.
I guess we had the same sort of sound in our heads.
Goodbye.
Brian is one of the most eccentric people that I've ever met. He's quite brilliant. When we met, he was doing a PhD in infrared astronomy, and he happens to be a damn fine guitar player. Also a complete nightmare to work with at times.
And you?
Me? I wouldn't dream of going into me.
So the lineup at this point then was drums, bass,
and guitar, but everybody sang.
Right.
And Tim, with the lead singer, had a tremendously powerful voice. He's done a few things since.
Do you think the Queen sound is there in Smile, isn't it? Yeah.
I think a lot of it is. Yes, it is, really. I think the basis of it is when me and Roger start hitting things. That's what Freddie saw, and in a sense fell in love with, I suppose. You know, he wanted that for his uses.
Freddie Mercury on vocals.
Freddie came from a colonial background. He was born in Zanzibar and he went to boarding school in India.
I first met Freddie at Ealing Art School in 1968, and there was a piano down there, and Freddie would do this kind of flowery style on the piano, and it was very Mozart and effective, but unique, you know. You'd never seen anybody play the piano like that before. The first time he sang, he knew straight away that that voice was going places.
I used to follow sort of Smile a lot, you know. Mm. I mean, we were like friends. I used to go to their shows.
Freddie was waiting in the wings, literally, and advising us on what to do.
And he would always say, you know, you guys are brilliant, 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 it's amazing. But, you know, you should do this and you should do this.
What did you see in what Brian and Roger were doing with Smile?
Nothing.
I think he sort of had in the back of his mind maybe, you know, some idea about maybe working with us.
Freddie told everybody that he was going to be a pop star, and we didn't take it that seriously, really. And he was sitting over there one night, and I walked in the pub, and he just put his head in his hands like this and looking really depressed. And I walked over and said, what's the matter with you? And I said, I'm not going to be a pop star. And very slowly, he stood up and he said, I'm going to be a legend.
Did
my diploma in graphics illustration, so I was going to be a graphics illustrator, you know. But while I was going through college, I mean, I was very interested in music, so I joined other bands and I got to know Brian and Roger. And then I realised that through college I spent more time rehearsing our songs and things than doing the other thing. But, I mean, I stayed there till I finished my diploma. And then I realised that the moment I finished that and I finished college, my interests were in music. All I wanted to do was music. So I set upon the fact that, oh, no, I'm going to try and make it as a singer.
He didn't suddenly become this rock star. He kind of always was, in a sense. He always believed he was a star. And he'd wander around as if he was Robert Plant, really. You know, but with a sense of humour, you know.
Although we'd had a lot of successful gigs and we played colleges and we played pubs and small clubs up and down the country, we just never got anywhere.
Smile made a single, which did nothing at all. And then Tim, our singer, got an offer from someone else, and the someone else was called Humpy Bong.
So Tim sodded off to that.
Smile sort of ground to a halt, really, because it had, we didn't have a good manager, we didn't really have anything, you know, we were lost in the wilderness. And we were also all students at the time. It ground to a halt. Tim lost interest, it didn't look like it was going anywhere.
So we decided we'd, you know, take the plunge. And it was then I sort of thought about the name Queen. You know, I had it in the back of my mind. I thought one day, you know, that could be, we could put that to good use.
Why Queen?
I don't know, at the time it was outrageous. The name sort of lent itself to a lot of things, a lot of the theatre and the kind of things that we wanted to do.
We then spent a couple of years looking for a bass player. We had several bass players. Very hard to find the right guy.
They had quite a few bass players, I hear. I never actually met any of them. I've heard some stories about... I've heard some stories about some of them. And I happen to have got my equipment down in London, so I got myself introduced to them and said I'd be interested. So basically I went along for an audition. I learned some of the songs, you know. They were doing a lot of some of the numbers. I remember things like Great King Rat and one or two other numbers off the first album. I came along in a way as a bit of an outsider at first, and it did take me quite a few years to sort of grow more into the group, you know, and find myself at, you know, at home, really.
We had the archetypal bass player, basically a quiet man, but with a terrific brain, hence his bass parts were all very, very considered and worked out well. But, you know, basically shy, not great with crowds of people, really. But then when he got off his head a bit, occasionally he could be a complete wild man.
It was only a, you know, a spare time thing, you know, even really, even with Queen, you know, I really didn't expect it to take off, really, you know.
I think John only realised that the whole thing was actually serious when we actually had an album that came out. I mean, up until then, he thought, oh, I'll just tag along with this.
The group were, in a way, very much well-formed, you know. I mean, they had all the material for the first album, all bar one or two tracks they were already doing, you know. I mean, they had quite a backlog of songs. And the ideas for stage production and, you know, how to put the group over were all there in a way.
As soon as John was in the band, it felt complete. I think we all knew that was the lineup as soon as John was there. You know, previously it had been bass players came and went, but John felt like he was part of the family, and we were a family from that point.
We were still a group of people without any contacts in the music business, without any way in, it seemed. I used to go and see groups at the Marquee and think, now, how do you get to that situation? And the answer was that people want to book you if they've heard of you, if you've made a record or something like that. How do you get to make records? Well, you get to make records because if you've played at places like the Marquee, where people notice you. And it was definitely head up against the brick wall department. First of all, we decided we were going to be ready when the opportunity came. So the first job was to rehearse and write to the point where we thought that we had an act worth presenting to the public. The second thing we thought was to make a good demonstration tape.
We had a lot of what we thought were good songs, and we were rehearsing ourselves up. We were sort of ready for it, but we couldn't find the door to walk through. Yeah. So one day this chap turned up, who's a friend of a friend, basically, working at Delane Lee Studios, the new Delane Lee Studios in Wembley, which was just being built, and they were testing the acoustics. And he said to me, we need a group to come in here and make some noise so that we can test all our lines and the soundproofing and whatever. And in return, we will make some tracks.
We had one demo tape on a little reel, and Fred and I were on the train to Wembley on some sort of desperate mission to try and flog this tape to another record company. And it was a hard slog round, you know. It didn't come overnight, but then suddenly when it did happen, it like sort of accelerated, yeah.
We were all students, so we'd run out of student grant. I was actually teaching in a comprehensive school to make ends meet.
I drove the odd van. Freddie and I had a stall for quite a while in Kensington Market. We used to flog old Edwardian scarves and Russian fox furs. I think Brian would have liked that very much. The first 3 years were really faith and fumes. We were very penniless, but we had a lot of faith and we had a lot of energy.
The band was first brought to my notice in 1971. My brother went and saw them at a nurse's dance in Norwood. And he came back and said they were really amazing. I was bought some tapes from Delaney's sessions that had taken place. And we listened to those, his test sessions, and we realized the band had amazing internal drive. Queen caught my imagination really by just their own ability, the way they worked together as a four-piece. It was totally interlocked in their thinking, their playing. And that was different to what was going on.
Before we signed to a record label, we actually signed to Trident Productions, a management company run by the Sheffield brothers, who had their own studio right in the middle of Soho.
Recording our first album, we were all still just students finishing off our degrees.
We had to do it in what time was available because, you know, the studio was being booked up all the time. So we had to go in, you know, sometimes at 2 o'clock in the morning and sometimes, you know, finishing at 6 in the morning. Yeah, all those sorts of weird times that nobody wanted.
You know, you could see the working girls at night through their lace curtains. So while we were mixing, we'd have a little bit of diversion.
So how long before the album came out was it recorded and finished?
Hard to remember. I'd say about a good year.
Mm.
It took so long, from the time of actually making those tapes. It's just quite unbelievable. I mean, the material was so old as far as we were concerned by then.
Mm.
As I remember it, John Anthony, our producer at the time, you thought Deke and John sounded rather mysterious and good. And I think Deke sort of went, well, I don't know, whatever. And then when it appeared on the album, he didn't like it. He said, no, I'm John Deacon, and I would prefer to be John Deacon.
We were in our management offices, and Fred just says, oh, by the way, I'm changing my name. And we said, really? What to? You know, I'm going to be Freddie Mercury.
And he started wearing wings on his trousers. Yeah. It was a sure sign something was going on.
Yeah.
In those days, it was kind of cool to just stand there and play your instrument and ignore the audience. But Freddie was always, no, we should present, we should connect, we should be dramatic, you know, we should get the material across. And of course he was right.
The album came out and sort of resoundingly crashed. Well, it didn't do much.
Well, it's funny when you make your first album, you know, you go out into the record shops and you think, oh, we're in the record stores now, you know, and you go in and say, have you got the new Queen album then? And they go, what? It's a long haul.